Our text for tonight is an easy text, except I'm going to change a little bit of the reading so that it's a little closer to the originals and the way Luther translated it. We read from Matthew chapter 11, beginning with the 25th verse. At that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and prudent and have revealed them to babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight. All things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Heavenly Father, sanctify us in the truth. Your word is truth. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It seems very strange that Jesus would say such words like this to start off this text. I thank you, Lord, that you've hidden this from some. When he says in other sections of Scripture that God wants all to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth, you got to be looking at this and saying, well, which one is it now? And to some extent, you're right, but to some extent, you have to understand what he's really talking about. When he starts off this way, he's recognizing that the haughty, those that think they know everything, often reject God's word and refuse to listen because they're too busy being right in their own mind. And it's not that it's Jesus' fault that they've rejected him, but it's their own fault for rejecting him. I've seen this in a lot of different ways as a pastor and over my lifetime, and we're seeing it in a lot of different ways in our world today. For almost 10 years, I did prison ministry. And it was always kind of interesting because I was never sure what I was going to get when I got in there every night. I wasn't sure who would be there in the group. One night I'll never forget because a nice young man said, well, Pastor came up to me and said, Pastor, it's good to have you here with us today. I want you to know that I gave my life to Jesus and I would like to testify tonight. I said, that's not needed. We're going to focus on the Word of God. And he looked at me, well, wait a minute, but I want to give my testimony. And I said, well, isn't it more important to hear God's? And he looked forlorn and lost, like, have you really understood that call to Christ, that he has to change your heart, not you do this and brag about it? In our world today, we're seeing this very same thing. That people are looking into themselves and deciding what's right and wrong. And it's being called wokeism. That as long as I'm right, I'm justified in going on and destroying the downtown area of different major cities. I'm justified in threatening people who don't see my point of view. Because I'm right. That's not the way to approach God and his word by any stretch of imagination, is it? And so we see Jesus reacting to that kind of thing, both in his time and all through time. We see that those that are educated or those that want to look down on God and those sheep that follow the master God that they need to have in their lives. This is not something new by any stretch of the imagination. And this is the heart of being a sinful human being, isn't it? That I put myself up here to the point where I don't have to listen to anybody else. And so we see this throughout time, and we still see this today, that as much as people have evolved, are things really that much better today than they were years ago? We see it in Luther's time. We're going to be studying this later on this fall, hopefully. In Luther's time, when Luther was locked up in the Wartburg and there was a vacuum in the leadership role in Lutheranism, everybody started going crazy. They started destroying all the stuff in the temples and in the churches. They started destroying all things that could be considered something to worship in the churches. You couldn't have any pictures of the saints or anybody else. They started claiming to have strange visions and so on. And Luther said, "Is this really from God? Or do you just think you're so great that you're going off in your own direction?" And so Luther wrote against these people, and it was these people that pulled Luther out of hiding. And Luther stressed, let the word work. Don't demand on changing everything in the church right away so that you hurt people's consciences and drive them away from Christ. Let the word work to bring about the change that needs to happen in the church. And he spoke against the Zwickau prophets, those that thought that they could preach and teach directly from God and not use the Bible. He spoke against the iconoclasts and those who would hurt and destroy and riot. And especially those who would operate in fear and in using fear. Boy, huh? Not much has changed again, has it? Our text reminds us, what do we need to be about? And as much as we're tempted to, well, we need to change something so that we can grow. Something's not right. We should be growing faster. Let the word of God work. It was the answer in Jesus' time. And yes, he warns us, there are those that were going to reject me, so be ready for it, because they'll reject you even if you come in my name as well. There's a great comfort for every pastor in that. That it's not me. That it's not on me. Let the word work. It carries more power than anything else does. It gives life. Not spreads death and fear. It gives life. And so what is church supposed to be about? It's being connected to Jesus and having him inside of us. And so what does he tell us? Come to me, all you who are heavy burdened. Maybe you don't even have to announce this, but I haven't been sleeping the greatest. I've had a few things on my mind, to say the least. Some things very pressing, because I have two calls from God, and I dare not take either one of them easily. And in a few weeks, I'm going on a vacation. Because I could use a break. Some refreshing. Some relaxing. And yet, I don't have to worry about my vacation because God's already taking care of it in His Word, isn't He? Come to me, all you who are heavy burdened and laden, and I will refresh you. This is often misquoted. I've even heard pastors preach on this, and they've misused this, thinking only that it's a rest that's afar off, the heavenly rest. And no, this is not the rest that's afar off. In fact, that grace, one of the absolutions quotes this passage. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will refresh you. It's the same thing that the pastor does on Sunday mornings or whenever. In the name of Jesus Christ, I forgive you your sins. He takes my burden off of me and places it on Jesus, who already paid for it at the cross. And He says, I'm switching places with you. You get to go sit on the throne of heaven, and you get to understand that I rule everything on your behalf. What do you have to worry about? I've got it. And instead of anything of fear or anger or self-promotion, God takes the poor sinner, the one that says, God, have mercy on me, a sinner, not the arrogant one that's boasting in front of God. You've heard that story, I'm sure. And He says, I lift you up. I raise you up. That is something for today. Not just eventually in a far off time, you'll get to go to heaven and finally be released from the problems of this world. It's today. When Jesus sent out the apostles to tell the people that salvation was at hand, it wasn't that, someday. It's, He's coming, and He's going to be in your town in the next couple of weeks or the next few days. Be ready for Him when He comes. Salvation is at hand. It's right now. You're going to see your Savior. And He tells us, go and tell the people I'm here. I have come. I've brought salvation. That's the one thing that I think the Old Testament text fits in with this Sunday of the church here. Rejoice greatly, O daughter, because your King is coming to you. He's there. That's the only connection I can kind of figure out why they would repeat that Old Testament text with this Sunday of the church year. I will refresh you. And in that, we have to hear the words of absolution and forgiveness. I have taken your yoke off of you. I have taken your sin and your guilt. Here, take my place. And then the other part of this that's really cool is if you are a student of English, if you look at I will give you rest and I will refresh you, there's a huge difference. Where's the action? It's on you, isn't it? Not indirectly, but directly with I will refresh you. It's pointed at you. I will do this to you, not you do this for me. Because that just puts more burden on us, doesn't it, when you think about it? I kind of relate to this, especially in my family, because I've always been the one that everybody calls when they need help. My aunt, who's 4'9", and my godmother, and she married a 4'11" Chinese man. When they've moved, they've called me and my children to come help because we're bigger. We can lift more. I've always been the one my father has depended upon because my brother had hay fever. He couldn't work outside in the yard and do all the mowing and stuff that I could do. And I know that in my ministry, I've had some heavy burdens to bear. How refreshing is it to have God say, no, no, no. I'm not giving you anything more to bear. I'm taking the yoke off. Because as much as you think you've borne something, guess who's borne a whole lot more? Not just my sins, but the sins of the world. Praise be to God. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, let that peace be with our hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus, unto life everlasting. Amen.